Going back now to our coverage of the earthquake in Mindanao, we'll be speaking once again to Agusan del Norte, Representative Lawrence Fortun. Congressman Fortun is questioning whether building standards are being enforced in the wake of damage sustained by homes and buildings in the earthquake-hit areas. Congressman Fortun, good afternoon again to you. I hope we have a clearer line to you this time.
Yes, Tony, good afternoon once again. As earlier said, Tony, we are alarmed now by the fact that in the series of earthquakes that have happened recently, several structures and buildings have been destroyed in Mindanao. The current count is about 2,700 already, and about half of that have been not only partially damaged but totally destroyed. And we are also worried that this might have been caused as well by the introduction of substandard construction materials, particularly steel products, that have been brought to the Philippine market by way of illegal smuggling activities through the Bureau of Customs. And this prompted this representation to file a resolution in the House of Representatives calling for investigation on this issue. We were alarmed by the alarms that were sounded by the Consumers Union of the Philippines, the Philippine Iron and Steel Institute, as well as the Association of Structural Engineers of the Philippines, regarding alleged proliferation of substandard construction materials that are being sold in the Philippines that have posed grave threats to the lives and properties of our countrymen. And since this is an appalling situation, Tony, we want this immediately investigated. This disturbing development or situation is said to be a result of smuggling steel products with misdeclared grades, lengths, sizes, and weights, as well as the replacement by our own local steel manufacturers of microalloyed steel bars with the so-called quench-tempered steel bars, without the knowledge, without disseminating information to the design engineering community, as well as our end users. And these quench-tempered steel bars are said to be significantly more brittle and not as durable as the MA steel bars, and thus making them unfit for use for construction of high-rise structures, especially in earthquake-prone countries like the Philippines.
Yeah. And in your investigation, who do you think should be called to testify and to actually explain why such substandard materials are being allowed to enter the Philippines and are also being used?
Well, essentially, we will summon the Department of Trade and Industry and the Bureau of Customs to the committee. Basically, these are the departments that should be asked why these substandard steel bars, steel materials, are being brought into the Philippine market.
And of course, the practice of using substandard materials has been going on for some time, as we've seen even in the recent earthquake that hit Pampanga, where a supermarket collapsed. And that investigation, I suppose, should also be included in your own resolution calling for an investigation of these substandard materials.
I think that's right, Tony. I understand the Department of Public Works and Highways also conducted an investigation. And we know that we note that this has started as early as 10 to 15 years ago. And this has given rise to significantly compromised structures in the country.
Well, in fact, ever since, I think, about 4 or 5 years ago, the DPWH already passed new regulations that called for stricter enforcement of the National Building Code. But somehow implementation is one thing, and putting all of these more stringent requirements in the law is another thing. How do you think our authorities who are responsible for enforcing the building code should be made to be more, held more accountable in actually implementing the law?
Yes, Tony, this is a lesson for all of us. we really think that there has been little or no enforcement at all of construction standards that should have been observed in the construction of structures and buildings in different parts of the country. And the recent events that have happened have demonstrated that indeed it is not remote, that there are issues, very serious issues in the implementation of this. And I think it's high time that we come up with stringent measures to compel people and agencies that are in charge with the implementation of these standards to really come up, to really comply with our regulations.
Yeah, and definitely, even local government officials who have to sign off on permits, especially for building safety clearances or structural permits, also have to be brought into the investigation, because some of these local government units may just be looking the other way and allowing these building developers to put up structures without complying with all the necessary regulations.
Yes, because they are the frontline implementers of our regulations. They are the ones that issue building permits, so necessarily the LGU should be included.
Mm. And somehow, given that all of these safety requirements are actually put into law, with your investigation, would we need more laws, or would just need more enforcement of existing laws?
It would depend, Tony, on what will come out in the investigation. But I think there might have to be certain reforms that have to be introduced, especially in terms of the provisions of the National Building Code. We note that the National Building Code is quite an old law, and there are new standards that have to be set already, considering the magnitude of recent disasters that have confronted our country. I think that there are reforms that should be introduced.
Mm. And you also authored a bill proposing the creation of a Department of Disaster Resilience. I mean, to your mind, how would that be better than the existing disaster response agencies that we already have?
Well, given the magnitude of the disaster problems we face regularly already, almost every year, we definitely need a separate department that would focus on prevention, response, recovery, rebuilding, and normalcy. Right now, the NDRRMC is simply a sort of a secretariat and a continuing ad hoc. It doesn't have any line or staff bureaus. It relies on the many other departments who are already busy with other mandates. So, nangihiram lang ng tao, panahon at resources ang NDRRMC. The continuing ad hoc nature means walang tutok, walang performance, walang permanence, and kapos sa prevention, adaptation, and mitigation. And the mandate and authority is lacking, and as well as the resources, which are very important. So we cannot entrust the lives of millions of Filipinos to an ad hoc system like that. The NDRRMC is a structural setup right now, or institutional setup, simply cannot withstand the wider, disasters or wider proportions that are happening in the country now.
Mm. And of course, the idea that we should have a Department of Disaster Resilience, also born out of the, existing agencies, perhaps like in the United States, where they have a Federal Emergency Management Agency.
Yes, and aside from that, the creation of the Department of Disaster Resilience will also include the creation of the National Disaster Resilience Council, which will serve as the policy advisory body to the department. And there will also be a creation of a multi-stakeholders convergence unit, which shall align their efforts in disaster resilience with the efforts of our government. And in the creation of the Department of Disaster Resilience, applicable powers, functions, and of course resources, funds from the Office of the Civil Defense, the Climate Change Office of the Climate Change Commission, the Geohazard Assessment and Engineering Geology Section of the Mines and the Geosciences Bureau, and other pertinent offices will be transferred already to the Department of Disaster Resilience. Mm. While those of the Philippine Atmospheric Geographical the PAGASA, no, and the Philippine Institute of Volcanology and Seismology will also be attached already to the department.
Mm. Now, as a final question, since we, of course, know that after every calamity, as with an earthquake, damaging or destroying structures, there will have to be some kind of rebuilding or rehabilitation done, would such a Department of Disaster Resilience be able to actually oversee that the reconstruction and rehabilitation are done according to the regulations stipulated in the National Building Code?
Yes, exactly, Tony. In fact, that is part of the function of the Department of Disaster Resilience. The aftermath, no, of the disasters that will happen, the DDR will be very much involved, including as well the rebuilding of structures that have been damaged by disasters.